Go to Google and type in site:moon hoax, and you'll get back over 670,000 websites that reference, in some way or another, that the moon landings were faked or we have never been to the moon at all. How did we get from one of the greatest technological achievements of the 20th century to believing that it was a massive cover-up by NASA, the CIA, the government, or a combination of all three? And why, almost 50 years after the first Apollo missions, with all the scientific proof available, do an increasing number of people believe in a radically different version of reality? One of the first reported instances of people not believing that the moon landings were true came on December the 18th, 1969, when the New York Times science reporter John Noble Wilford, in an article called "A Moon Landing? What Moon Landing?", remarked that a few stool warmers in the Chicago bars are on record as suggesting that the Apollo 11 moonwalk last July was actually staged by Hollywood on a Nevada desert. 6 months later, on June 15, 1970, the Atlanta Constitution led with a story: many skeptics feel moon explorer Neil Armstrong took his first giant step for mankind somewhere in Arizona. The article was based on a poll of 1,721 US citizens that were asked, "Do you really completely believe the United States has actually landed men on the moon and returned them to the Earth again?" The poll results showed that less than 5% of the responders in Detroit, Miami, and Akron believed they were fake, but this increased to 54% of African Americans in places like Washington, D.C. An early conspiracy theme is that because of the Cold War between the US and the Soviets, the US could not be seen to lose the race to the moon. But when they realized that it couldn't be done, NASA faked the missions and used the funds to buy the silence of potential whistleblowers. Another one says that we could never get to the moon because the astronauts would have been killed by the radiation in the Van Allen belts which surround the Earth. This is down to a poor understanding of the science of radiation, and that thinking all radiation is the same. As we will see, it's this bad science that is the underpinning of most of the moon hoax theories. One theory by William Bryan said that we did go to the moon, but only with the help of alien technology, and NASA couldn't risk the public finding out about this, as they would then have to disclose how they got it. Another, by Richard Hoagland, says that NASA had discovered large artificial glass structures on the lunar surface, and that the astronauts had had their memory of any alien encounters erased by hypnosis. He also said that the moon landing hoaxes had been created by NASA themselves to act as disinformation to put people off the bigger picture of the aliens they had found. You may well recognize a similarity to the plot of the 1968 Stanley Kubrick film 2001: A Space Odyssey, which in turn was based on a 1964 short story by Arthur C. Clarke called The Sentinel. This was well before the moon landings and any of the subsequent moon conspiracy theories, so you can see where these ideas can come from. Over time, these same early themes have been recycled again and again, with changes added here and there. One thing that does remain the same, though, is that they are all different. If NASA had concocted a hoax, there could only be one version of it. It wasn't until 1975 when the first of the so-called evidence-based denials appeared by Bill Kaysing, a journalist who had worked for Rocketdyne Incorporated, the makers of the F1 engines that powered the Saturn V moon rockets. His 1975 self-published booklet titled "We Never Went to the Moon, America's $30 Billion Swindle", which was republished in 1981 and 2002, is acknowledged as the first to lay out many of the arguments which have been taken up by the subsequent conspiracy theorists. It's here that we see the bad science at work, as he puts forward the missing stars in the photos of the astronauts, the flag waving when there is no air, the lack of a blast crater from under the lunar lander from its descent, and optical anomalies in photos taken on the moon. He also puts forward the assumption that NASA did not have the technical expertise to operate the moon landings, and that the F-1 rockets were so unreliable, the ones on the Apollo 11 rocket were faked, with smaller B-1 type engines inside of them. This later point has been proven to be incorrect by the recovery of the actual F-1 engines used on Apollo 11 from the Atlantic Ocean by Jeff Bezos, the owner of Amazon. Kazing, who was neither a scientist nor engineer, worked as the head of the technical publications and as a publications analyst at Rocketdyne until May 31, 1963, some 6 years before the moon landings. He said he came to these and later conclusions because he had seen documents relating to Mercury, Gemini, Atlas and Apollo, and that you didn't need to be a trained professional to know a hoax was being perpetrated. Kazing's theories subsequently became even more extreme when he alleged that NASA had staged the Apollo 1 fire and the Space Shuttle Challenger disaster because the astronauts were about to reveal the hoax and they had to silence them in a convincing manner. Hollywood has also helped to popularize the moon hoaxes with films like the 1978 Capricorn 1, which deals with NASA faking a Mars mission due to technical problems discovered just before the launch that would have killed the astronauts if they'd continued, and the ensuing cover-up. In 2001, the conspiracy theorists received a huge boost with a Fox TV documentary called Conspiracy Theory: Did We Land on the Moon? The program aired on mainstream TV and Bill Kazing was one of the main contributors. Because this came out over 30 years after the moon landings, it reintroduced the conspiracy theories to a new audience, many of which, without a technical understanding, would have found it compelling in its arguments. But the program didn't offer a reply to the allegations, which included that astronauts and others had died in mysterious circumstances to hide the so-called truth. This is where the US government and NASA have been their own worst enemy in creating an atmosphere of distrust and enabling the conspiracies to develop. Things like the Watergate debacle, the Iran-Contra affair, and the refusal of NASA to talk about the allegations because they thought they were just too absurd to warrant a reply just helped the conspiracy theorists' arguments. An opinion poll conducted in 1964 marked a high point for the public's belief in the government, with 76% of people saying that they believed that the US government would do what is right most or all of the time. By the early 1990s, that figure had fallen to less than 25%. It's one thing to create conspiracy theories, but you still need people to believe in them. This is where the emphasis moves from the hoax creators to the believers and evangelizers that embrace and repeat the conspiracy theories, often with little regard to the poor and incorrect understanding of the science that these theories are based on. Belief is the major component here. There is a basic tenet in psychology in that once someone firmly believes in something, whether that be conspiracy theories, politics, religious beliefs, aliens, ghosts, or whatever, no matter what proof is forwarded to the contrary, it can be almost impossible for them to change their minds because they want to believe in them. And for some, it's to the point of fanatical hostility when repeatedly challenged. In fact, there is a phenomenon known as the backfire effect, where the more aggressively someone asserts a particular viewpoint with scientific proof like NASA, the more it pushes the conspiracy believers in the opposite direction and reinforces their convictions. So why are some people drawn to the alternative viewpoints and others not? This tendency cuts across age, race, gender, occupation, and political standing. One area that does show a difference, though, is education. Research carried out by the University of Miami using long-term empirical data found that people with a high school education were almost twice as likely at 42% to believe in conspiracy theories of all types compared to ones with postgraduate degrees at 23%. A recent poll carried out by the Fairleigh Dickinson University showed that 63% of registered US voters believed in at least one political conspiracy theory. According to Professor of Psychology Viren Swamy of Westminster University, England, once you believe in one conspiracy theory, you are much more likely to believe in others. Psychological testing has revealed that people are more susceptible to conspiracy theories if they feel anxious, under stress, or feel that they don't have control over their lives. This is believed to trigger some people to see non-existent patterns and attributing conspiratorial explanations. Compared to the 60s, 70s, and even 80s, the world is now a very different place. The so-called surveillance society, with its privacy issues, leaks about eavesdropping on web browsing and emails, job uncertainty, poverty, terror attacks, and a highly unequal society and living in a rapidly changing and unpredictable world all contribute to the feeling of lack of control for a great deal more people than it did in the past. The internet has made things worse in a way, with a world of information, both good and bad, just a Google search away. The problem here is of confirmation bias. This is the tendency to only believe the evidence that supports your point of view, and the tribalism of people that occurs on chat rooms, blogs, forums, and YouTube channels also helps reinforce the false information and the us and them view of the world. Whilst believing that you know that NASA faked the moon landings might make you feel in control, it doesn't actually give you any control. The problem with this lack of faith in scientific endeavour is, where will it take you in the future? To some, it seems no matter what NASA or others might do, there will always be some form of hidden agenda. And this negates from the achievements that NASA did 50 years ago, and for those which are still yet to come. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you did, then please thumbs up, subscribe, share, and comment. And don't forget, we have other videos available which you may also find interesting on the link which is showing now. So until the next time, it's goodbye from me.